Live from the studios of Vermont PBS in Colchester, the Vermont Votes 2016 debates. Tonight, the candidates for U.S. Senate debate the top issues in this important election season. Here's moderator Joe Merone.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's debate among the candidates for one of the two seats in the United States Senate representing Vermont. I'm Joe Merone, and I'll be moderating tonight's debate between those seeking to represent you for the next six-year term in Washington. And let me introduce them to you now. Pete Diamondstone from Dummerston is the Liberty Union candidate. Chris Erickson is from Chester, representing the United States Marijuana Party. Patrick Leahy of Middlesex is the incumbent Democratic candidate. Scott Milne from Pomfret is the Republican. And independent Jerry Trudell, who lives in Derby, with us tonight. Candidates, welcome to you all. Joining me also here tonight on the dais, Paul Heintz, political reporter from 7 Days. And I'd like to remind everyone of tonight's format. Relatively straightforward. Questions will come from myself and from Paul. We'll also have topics that have been emailed to us from Vermont PBS viewers. Questions will be posed to all candidates, and each of them will have 1 minute to answer. There may be time for follow-ups and rebuttals for each topic. And there are also opening and closing remarks of 1 minute apiece. Laura Walsh is our timekeeper. Keep everyone on time. We opened the show by drawing lots for the opening statement, and Scott Milne, you drew number one, but I'd like to first point out for the record, Mr. Milne, you are a friend of both myself and Vermont PBS. You're a former board member here, and your company is also a corporate sponsor to Vermont PBS. So with that out of the way, sir, 1 minute opening statement.
Thank you very much, Joe. Thanks, Vermont PBS and fellow candidates. In a little less than 2 weeks, Vermont will elect a United States Senator for 2 years. I've decided to run for the United States Senate because I realize and I believe that our nation and our planet are in perilous times. The old ideas are not working. Our Senate is a broken, dysfunctional organization. It's become that over the last 50 years. The primary reason that our Senate is not working is because of this deadly concoction of special interest money fueling career politicians election cycle after election cycle after election cycle. I've taken a two-term pledge. I'm going to work to get term limits in the United States. I'm not taking any special interest money. Our campaign is all volunteers. I'm walking the walk of what I'm talking about. I'm looking forward to being elected in a little less than 2 weeks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Milne. Next up, Mr. Diamondstone for opening statement.
Peter Diamondstone, Liberty Union candidate for the U.S. Senate. And there's one party over there and one party over here. Those are the capitalist candidates. I'm the socialist candidate. And it makes sense that they would need so many to outnumber a sick and ailing socialist. In spite of my not-so-good health, I'm willing to serve and to be the peace candidate. No more shipping of weapons or armaments out of the United States. A total embargo. We are the world's supplier of war. And we're going to stop that if I'm elected to the U.S. Senate and if I get my way in the U.S. Senate. I want total disarmament of the United States of nuclear weapons and so-called conventional weapons, which are also nuclear arms.
Thank you, Mr. Diamondstone. I do want to point out that, as is custom, everyone is seated here, alphabetical, left to right. So the way it turns out is the way it turns out. Next up, for Patrick Leahy, for opening statements.
Well, thank you very, very much, Joe and Paul and Vermont PBS for doing this. I hope we can have a civil and constructive debate. Our last one, I know I was called down here a war criminal and anti-woman and career politician, among other things. I think Vermonters, what I hear as I go around the state, they're tired of name calling, they're tired of negative campaigns. They want to talk about constructive things. So let's talk about how we bring jobs back to Vermont, the way I've done with the Vermont Center for Emerging Technology or at Darn Tough Socks. Or let's talk what we can do to fix our infrastructure. We began after Irene, but we have a lot more to go. What do we do about comprehensive immigration reform? How do we address global climate change? And then I feel Lake Champlain is a great lake. We've done an awful lot to clean it up. What do we do to make sure that continues? So I'm looking forward to having important issues discussed, not negative ones.
Thank you very much, sir. Next up for opening statement, Jerry Trudell.
Thank you very much. Taking a cue from you, Senator Leahy, what I'd like to propose is a blueprint for prosperity, my 10-point plan. Because the number one problem, according to all surveys, is the economy. Vermonters struggling to make ends meet, families struggling to connect the dots, people working harder and harder for less and less, senior citizens on fixed incomes. We have the poorest rich country in the world, and there's no excuse for cut. My proposal to finance this, I'm calling the 1% solution, which is an investment tax on Wall Street to finance the rebuilding of America. And yes, Senator Leahy, I do want to be very constructive, very nuts and bolts, and very specific. We need to rebuild America and create prosperity for all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Trudell. Last for opening statement, Chris Erickson.
Hi, I'm Chris Erickson, and Patrick Leahy has bragged a lot about how much money he's brought back from Washington, D.C. to Vermont. So if you vote for me, I promise I'm going to go around to some Vermont farms and take photographs of Vermont pigs. I'm going to get photos of the gigantic pigs that are as big as some cars. And I'm going to put them in my office down there in Washington, D.C. when you vote for me for U.S. Senator. And when the other senators come over to my office and say to me, well, why don't you vote on our bill? I'll say, well, where's the pork for Vermont in it? And I will make certain that for every bill I vote on in Washington, D.C., there's going to be pork in it for Vermont. And that means funding for federal programs for Vermont. Thank you.
Thank you much, Chris Erickson. First question, candidates. We're going to talk about the Senate, the body where you would like to serve. The national election is less than 2 weeks away, and along with the presidency and all seats of the House, one-third of the Senate is up for re-election. Starting with Mr. Trudell, what party would you caucus with, sir? And who do you hope to see as majority leader?
Any qualified candidate for majority leader of any party. I'm nonpartisan, I'm an independent, and I'm willing to work on good faith with anyone from any political party to develop relationships that we need to do in order to get things done in Washington, D.C.
Simple enough. Mr. Milne.
Thanks for the question, Joe. One of the big problems we have in Washington right now is, unlike when George Aiken represented Vermont, there are a lot of these New England Republicans and Dixie Democrats that worked in the middle to get things done. That brand of U.S. senator is virtually extinct. So I'll offer a compromise to you, Senator Leahy. If you concede, I'll vote for whoever you'd like me to for majority leader for the first vote in the United States Senate. Otherwise, if it's an election I win and we don't talk about it till afterwards, I'm going to vote for the Republican leader.
Thank you, sir. Senator Leahy.
Well, we know who the Republican leader will be, Mitch McConnell, and I think Mr. Milne is very honest in saying he's going to vote for him. But I point out that Mitch McConnell has done an unconstitutional thing. He has blocked any ability to fill one of the major vacancies in the United States Supreme Court. He wants more Republicans to be elected so he can continue to do that. I intend to make sure he doesn't have one from Vermont, and I will vote for the Democratic leader.
Chris Erickson.
Hi, I'm Chris Erickson, United States Marijuana Party, which means I will function as an independent. When any other senator from the Republicans or Democrats comes to me and asks me to vote on their bill, I'll say, first of all, where's the pork in it for Vermont? And what is that bill going to do for Vermont? Is it going to hurt Vermonters in any way? Is it going to help Vermonters in any way? Is it going to reduce unnecessary rules and regulations written by unelected officials? So I'm going to get down to the brass tacks and say, how's it going to help Vermont? If you want my vote, you show me how your bill is going to help Vermont. Thank you.
Mr. Diamondstone, control of the Senate may change. Who are you going to vote for a leader?
Myself. I'm going to head up the Socialist Party caucus in the U.S. Senate, and I hope to have the opportunity to speak much louder than this soft-spoken war criminal who now serves us. Liberty Union has determined that our congressional delegation is made up of war criminals because of their aiding and abetting war crimes around the world, aiding and abetting Saudi Arabia in its bombing of Yemen, aiding and abetting the Zionist government in Palestine in the invasion of Gaza, both of which constitute at least basic war crimes of which he is partially responsible, and responsible in a way that he understands. The perpetrator is the perpetrator, but those who aid and abet are as guilty as the perpetrators themselves. And his soft-spoken voice does not change the fact that he's a war criminal.
So you were mentioned, we'll give you time for rebuttal on that if you'd like.
I'm a war criminal, of course I'm not. And no Vermonter thinks I am.
All right.
No, I do.
Okay, one Vermonter.
Rebuttal.
Actually, no, I've got to move on because actually Mr. Dimasone mentioned Mr. Leahy. I gave him time to rebut that, and I have another question. You are all familiar faces to us here. You have run, except for Mr. Milne, 5 times at least, we counted up beforehand, for statewide office. Peter, much more, I know. I said at least 5 times. Please name us one policy proposal you're pushing this campaign that you haven't in previous campaigns. We'll start with Mr. Dimasone.
Oh, total unilateral disarmament, nuclear and traditional or conventional weapons by the United States. Not 1 cent for the war budget, not 1 cent. Those monies that would go for Veterans Affairs would go through Social Security. But the Department of War is over. They changed it from Department of War to Department of Defense so that they could put people in prison for refusing to serve in the Second World War because the Constitution authorizes defense, but it doesn't authorize war. Yeah. I mean, that was part of the...
Thank you, sir.
I'm
sorry. My mistake.
We're going to end war. And since the United States is the wellspring of all violence internationally, I mean, ISIS is using U.S. weapons. Saudi Arabia is using U.S. People all around the world are using weapons sold by the United States. We're going to stop that.
Chris Erickson, something new from you that we haven't heard.
Yes, something new from me. I went on WNYT Albany, New York recently for a quick news segment. I don't know if they've aired it or not. And something occurred to me at the last moment, and I said, you know, test for marijuana, roadside tests that... police are very concerned about marijuana being legalized soon, and they want a roadside test. But the marijuana people, the advocates of legalization, are opposed to urine test and blood test because the marijuana stays in the system long after the high is gone. So I thought of something brand new. I would like the police to whip out an iPad and say, okay, here, do a little math test and see if you can walk a straight line. But iPads have cameras on them, they have sound on them, they can capture a person taking the math test and really see if somebody's competent and capable. And I think that would be a much better roadside test rather than urine or blood, and that's a new idea I had.
Thank you very much. Mr. Leahy.
Well, one thing I've never had to say I was gonna push for, because we take an oath to uphold the Constitution and follow the Constitution. But the Republican leader, Mr. McConnell, has said, we're not going to follow the Constitution. We're not going to allow a vote for Justice Scalia's replacement. And now we have some of the key members of the Republican Party saying, if we stay in the majority, we may not allow any votes on any Supreme Court justices for the next 4 years. That violates the Constitution. I will do everything possible to get people who've taken an oath, sworn unto God that uphold the Constitution, to actually do so.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Milne.
Senator Leahy and I agree on his proposal. I'll remind folks, I ran for governor 2 years ago. I had two basic philosophies that I thought founded that campaign. The more locally decisions can be made, the better. And that as governments, we need to really be focused on doing what's practical versus what's political. As I looked at a federal office race, as I looked at the gentleman that I'm running against, to me is the biggest impediment that's on a ballot in 2016 in Vermont. between me today and me being optimistic 20 years from now that I did everything I could to make America and the world a better place for my kids and grandkids. I would say this time I've also talked a little bit about a fundamental belief which will be a foundation of my service to Vermont as your United States Senator, should I be fortunate enough to get elected, is that I believe all people are created equal. Proposals that I'm bringing that are built on those three foundations, term limits, getting special interest money out of politics.
Thank you, sir. Something new from the Jerry Trudell campaign.
Thank you. I am proposing a blueprint for prosperity, something that is a comprehensive plan that no one else has. In fact, the closest thing Senator Leahy has that he can claim to be a substantial economic proposal just imploded. That was the EB-5 scandal. I'm proposing a 10-point plan and what I'm calling the 1% solution, which is an investment tax on Wall Street so that we can finance this without raising taxes one penny, one iota for any working person in this country. Do I have any more time? Great, because it is deplorable that we have the poorest rich country in the world. There is no excuse for this when we have the skills, the tools, and the dreams to create a prosperity for us all in our time. And that's why I'm running. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Paul, do you have a follow-up?
I have a new question for you both, for you all. Senator Leahy, you've served 42 years in office. Mr. Millen, you've proposed term limits of 12 years. For each of the candidates, please tell us whether you think experienced leadership would better serve Vermont or new leadership. And would you propose any changes to the rules of how long a senator could serve?
Let's begin with Senator Leahy first.
Well, we do have term limits. It's called elections. Mm-hmm. Every 2 years for our governor, every 2 years for our House of Representatives, every 6 years for senators. I know my predecessor was elected the year I was born and served till I got there. I think Vermont gained a great deal because of his tenure and his seniority. Vermonters are the ones who are going to make that decision. People talk about a constitutional amendment, which we know won't pass, but I don't want Washington making the decision. I want my fellow Vermonters to make it. I think they're well qualified to. If they feel I've been there too long or anybody else, they'll vote for somebody else.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Milne.
Obviously, I completely disagree. I think this deadly concoction of special interest money, which has infected Washington over the last 42 years, is ruining our country. I believe that Senator Leahy is a poster child for what's gone wrong in Washington in the last 42 years. The gentleman that served from the time he was born until the time he got elected spent $5,000 on 34 years worth of statewide elections in Vermont. He didn't take money from special interests. He didn't have a 65-person staff to run around and help him get reelected. He did it based on representing Vermonters in a truly democratic way. Times have changed. We need to change with it. 96% of incumbent senators that run for reelection get elected. So it's not really all this likely that people lose. And if we look at where this money is coming from, Eisenhower was a prophet when he left office in 1960, said beware of the military-industrial congressional complex. The gentleman that I'm running against is a poster child for Eisenhower being a prophet.
Thank you, Mr. Mill. Mr. Trudell, term limits.
I'd like to quote Senator Leahy. This is a 42-year-old quote. It's time to bring a fresh new approach and leadership to government. Term limits, I think, would be very useful because of something called the seniority system, which creates entrenched power brokers who bottle up good legislation in committee. Those of you who are familiar with the committee system know exactly what I'm talking about. There are pros and cons to everything. Certainly, experience does count. I can't say that it doesn't. But what we also need is to break this congressional logjam. So I strongly support term limits. And I'd like to ask you, would you have supported term limits for Senator Aiken?
You asking me?
Yes, because you didn't seem to be too clear on that.
I think
you're taking Mr. Trudell's time. Go ahead.
Thank you, Jerry. I'll bring you an Abnaki book next time we see each other.
I already have a few.
I did not, and I paid a lot of attention to politics. I did not pay attention. I did not believe that we needed term limits until we see what's happened over the last 42 years. This deadly concoction of special interest money and career politicians is ruining things.
Mr. Diamond's on term limits and experience versus new fresh faces.
Point out that socialists can work across the aisle with the capitalists, even when he's a war criminal. I tend to agree with Senator Leahy that we already have term limits and they're called elections. And I would support that as the only form of term limits, and I would get rid of it as it exists in the for presidents in this currently in the Constitution. We need to make some other changes where I totally disagree with them. For example, we need to cut production. We don't need to produce more crap. We need to produce less crap. And we begin by cutting the work week to 20 hours of work for 40 hours of pay. That's one way to begin to put money in people's hands, increase leisure time, and make sure that we stop producing so much crap.
Thank you, sir. Chris Erickson.
I'll agree the term limits are, you know, handled through elections, but Senator Leahy has got to go, and he's got to go now, because he's bringing the F-35 strike fighter jets to Vermont, and they're designed to be dual capable to carry nuclear bombs. Senator Leahy has allowed Lake Champlain, from which one-third of Vermonters draw their drinking water, to continually be filthy with treated sewage being dumped into it from dozens of treated sewage plants all around the lake. That's disgusting. Senator Leahy has not brought enough money from the U.S. Congress federal funding for senior and disabled housing. I live in Chester, Vermont. There's one family with an autistic child. They're foreclosing because they have to spend all their time taking care of the autistic child. Another senior citizen woman I met in the dollar store yesterday said she can't find a place to rent. There's not enough senior citizen disabled housing. And Senator Leahy has ignored that.
Senator, you were mentioned. We'll give you some time.
Well, I've been mentioned by everybody in an attack, and
we love you.
I'm not going to try to respond to all of them, because what I've found, I've gone all over the state. I've talked with thousands of people. Almost everywhere I go, Republicans and Democrats, they tell me, we are tired of this negative campaigning. We're tired of negative ads. And they thank me for the fact that I've never run a negative ad. I don't run a negative campaign, and I'm not going to start it now.
Thank you, sir. Paul?
To each of the candidates, what committee do you most want to serve on in the United States Senate? What committee do you think would most serve Vermonters? And specifically to Senator Leahy, you have the opportunity to chair, if the Democrats take over the Senate, the Appropriations Committee, the Judiciary Committee, and the Agriculture Committee. Which of those would you prefer to chair? Start with you, Senator.
Well, a lot is going to make a difference of whether we take over the majority or not, and I'll decide then. I've been able to do a lot of things on each one of them. Agriculture, as you mentioned, I enjoyed being chairman because I wrote the Organic Farm Bill. It's now a $35 to $40 billion industry nationwide. I'm proud of that. I wrote the farm to school program, and I still am able to do that because of my seniority. Appropriations, people think it's easy to get a small state minimum. It's not. Each appropriations, you have to seek it, and I've done that. But judiciary, I worry very much of how we have politicized and how the Republican leadership has politicized our federal judiciary. I want to get us back to having regular order, the same way Democrats did when they were in power and you had a Republican president. We put through Republican judges. We put through Republican Supreme Court justices.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Milne, what committees do you want to serve?
Well, I sure hope the fact checkers are paying attention to what Senator Leahy just said. It doesn't pass a straight face test. I would say that I'm running a campaign which is designed to send a message from Vermont that we're sick and tired of the way things are going in the United States Senate and it needs to be reformed. I'm offering myself as that messenger. I believe the day after the election, should I be fortunate enough to win, I will accomplish more with my election than my opponent has accomplished in the last 6 years. I'd like to be on foreign relations. I think agriculture is important to Vermont, but I'll serve wherever it works out for me. I'm not running to pretend I'm going to be the expert on foreign relations in the whole Senate. I'm offering myself to Vermont as a message that things need to change.
Mr. Trudell, where do you want to serve?
I guess tied for first place would be agriculture, energy, and transportation.
No particular order.
I have high priorities for all of the above because it's about survival. When it comes to agriculture, I would like to point out that among the things Senator Leahy did, eliminating direct payments in favor of crop insurance, which hurt 80% of farmers, small and medium sized. So when it comes to farm policy, we're actually losing small farmers in spite of the public relations we hear. So I'm very interested in farm policy, I'm very interested in energy policy, very interested in transportation policy, because these are all survival issues here. And it's hard for me to say which one, like I say, they're all tied for first place.
Thank you. Where is Senator Diamondstone going to serve?
In the Socialist Caucus, until we get some more socialists in that caucus, I will serve as the chair of all of them, beginning with government operations, where we need to investigate the lie that comes up over and over again when you hear the phrase Twin Towers. There is no such thing as Twin Towers. There's triple towers or there's no towers. Until we start getting it straight and how it came to be, that inside job that brought those towers down, my caucus is the one that's going to carry on the investigation, bringing such people as that Reverend who's written so much about it and some other people, and the architects who have claimed that it can't possibly be that this was brought down by jet airplanes. And I'm not interested in the 1% tax on the wealth of the stock market. I want a confiscatory tax, takes it all away from them. The ownership of the major means of production and distribution belongs in the hands of the people.
Thank you, sir. Chris Erickson.
I'd be interested in the Rules Committee, because too many bills don't get anywhere because of the rules, the way the rules are in the Senate. They get shot down. They don't get a chance to, float somebody's boat and get going. The other thing is the U.S. Senate Ethics Committee. I'm very interested in that. I called them up one time many years ago, and I said, Senator Leahy took campaign donations from my opposing attorneys. I don't think that was right. And they said, you can't prove it. And of course I could prove it. It was clear as a bell. It was on the Federal Election Commission website. But they lied for him. So the U.S. Senate Ethics Committee seems like some kind of con job for the Judiciary Committee, which is like a fixer to get cases thrown out of court that shouldn't be thrown out of court. I think U.S. Senator Patrick Leahy is the number one criminal in the United States of America for fixing cases that shouldn't be thrown out of court and getting them thrown out and taking money from opposing attorneys to get cases thrown out. I think you're a criminal.
Going to give you time to rebut that, sir.
You know, I could take, I guess, 30 seconds with each, all four of them for attacking me. I'm not going to do that. You know, I've run a number of times, as been pointed out. I've had opponents, some, who ran very negative campaigns against me during a time when they probably would have won otherwise. They lost. I'm not going to run a negative campaign. I'm not going to make negative charges about any of my opponents. It would be totally out of character for me. I found running a positive campaign, saying what I'll do for Vermont, how I'll do it, has gotten me elected in the past, and I intend to keep doing that.
Thank you. It's just about top of the hour. If you're joining us, this is the Vermont PBS debate for the United States Senate. We have five candidates here today who want to represent you in Washington for the next six-year term. Peter Diamondstone, Liberty Union. Chris Erickson, United States Marijuana. Patrick Leahy, Democrat. Scott Milne, Republican. And Mr. Jerry Chidell, Independent. We've got some emails in from viewers who would like to question these candidates, and I'd like to go to Cooper Babbitt in Rutland. And one of you mentioned the Supreme Court earlier, so this ties in. John McCain recently said in an interview that, "I promise you that we will be united against any Supreme Court nominee that Hillary Clinton, if she were to be president, would put up." Question: regardless of who wins the presidency, will you pledge to uphold your constitutional responsibility as a member of the Senate to approve qualified jurists appointed by the president? And let's start with Mr. Diamondstone.
Beginning with a yes to that part of the question that's directed to the Supreme Court, I would have been involved in saying yes to that guy a week after he was nominated. But there are other things that we have other obligations in that investigation that I spoke of previously. I would want to use a subpoena power and call Senator Leahy to the stand in my caucus and committee and say, why did you appropriate $100 billion for the Saudis to bomb Yemen? Those are war crimes. The abettor is as guilty as the perpetrator. He knows that. He's a lawyer. He's a criminal lawyer. He was a criminal lawyer. So the things that need to be done are broader than simply responding to requiring the senators to approve the advise and consent to the appointments of the president. The other one is, let's find out why we got $100 billion, and maybe he would like to explain that $100 billion for the bombing of Yemen.
Thank you. Chris Erickson, question on the table is the United States Supreme Court.
The question, I believe, was would I go along with Hillary Clinton?
Would you pledge to uphold your constitutional responsibility as a member of the Senate to approve qualified jurists appointed by the president?
Okay, well, it depends on whether or not it's Hillary Clinton.
This questioner assumes that it is, yes.
Okay, that's a horrible and terrifying and frightening assumption. really bad assumption. Hillary Clinton is a snake in the grass. Therefore, anyone she nominates has to be vetted very, very carefully. And my first instinct would be to say, no way in holy hell would I go along with anything she wants. But if she goes along with a few things I want, for example, rerouting treated sewage away from Lake Champlain to industrial uses or south to the Atlantic Ocean, because it is a freshwater lake and one-third of Vermonters draw their drinking water from the lake. If she goes along with helping get more housing, federally funded housing for seniors and disabled people in Vermont. If she goes along with getting dental care and housing for all veterans. And if she puts a stop to what's going on with small farms. When I was a kid, there were 25,000 small farms in Vermont. Now there's only 2,000. Senator Leahy has destroyed small farms in Vermont.
Senator Leahy, Supreme Court.
I was going to say, get back to the original question. I will vote for a qualified person to the U.S. Supreme Court. I voted for nominees of Republican presidents and Democratic presidents. I voted against those that I thought were not qualified. And the idea that Senator McCain and others have said, if they have enough Republicans there, they will not allow any Supreme Court nominees to be confirmed. That means you're not going to follow your oath of office. The Constitution says the president shall nominate. In this case, he's done that. We also raise our hand and say, we swear to uphold the Constitution, which says we shall advise and consent. Well, then do so. Have the guts to vote either yes or no, but vote. They're not doing their job now. They want more Republicans. Mitch McConnell and others have said they do, so they can stop justices. That's wrong. It hurts every one of us. I will not go along with that.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Milne.
John McCain, actually my son Keith, who's one of my key volunteers, John McCain was your congressperson when you were born in Phoenix. So sorry to hear John McCain say that. If you want to take me up on my endorse me offer, either way, I'm going to be like Senator Leahy if Hillary Clinton is president. I believe presidents deserve great discretion in nominating Supreme Court justices and having them appointed. Unlike my opponent, I'll feel the same way 4 years from now if it's a Republican president or a Democratic president. He's got a history of obstructing presidents of the opposite party and being in the bag, essentially, for presidents of his party. I think with the Supreme Court, I'll be a moderate George Aiken New England Republican, and I'm going to be very supportive, by and large, of Hillary Clinton's choices if she's president.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Trudell, how about yourself?
Well, as an independent candidate, on principle, I would support any nominee of either the Republican or Democratic parties, based on their qualifications. Now, I think the party of Lincoln has great history, and I think that the Democratic Party has great history. I'm not partial towards either one. I've never been registered as a Democrat or a Republican. I truly don't care which party does what, as long as they do the right thing, even if it's for the wrong reason. I think we need more independent candidates in Congress for that reason. We need to build bridges, and we need to construct relationships. So, again, just to reiterate the original question, yes, I would support any qualified candidate of any political party or no political party.
Thank you, sir.
When I was attacked and said I obstruct judges, I voted for between 95% and 98% of all federal judges in both parties. I'll give you one very clear example. A Democratic leader went on the floor of the Senate and announced that he and many of the caucus would vote against John Roberts for Chief Justice, who had just been nominated by George Bush. I was the second person to speak after he did. I said I would vote for John Roberts. He would not have been my first choice, but I felt the president had nominated a qualified person, and he had the right to have a vote.
Quick follow-up to that, Senator Leahy. Which Supreme Court nominees have you voted against in your career, and why?
Well, one was Clarence Thomas. And I stated at the time, I felt he lied. And I still feel he lied. I felt Anita Hill told the truth, and that he lied before our committee. And I said, that's why I voted against him. He also, in answer to a question I asked, gave an answer that nobody believed, Republican or Democrat.
Chris Erickson, you brought up your feelings about Hillary Clinton a little bit earlier. I want to ask each of you, who do you plan to vote for president on November 8th, and why do you hope to vote for that person? And why don't we start with Mr. Diamondstone this time?
Oh, it's nice to have to answer that question here, because this open program that alleges that it's exposing the people to all the candidates on the ballot, it has done so with all the Democrats and Republicans, but it hasn't done that with Gloria LaRiva, who is on our ballot in Vermont and is a candidate of the Peace and Freedom Party. But if you're a nutcase in Utah, you get some exposure on public television. If you're a so-called libertarian or phony libertarian, or a far progressive like Stein, you get some exposure because as long as you're capitalists. But as soon as you put up a socialist, even though she's on the ballot, you have not given her the opportunity to speak on these programs, because you're a little one-sided. Although we got one of me is enough to deal with five of them.
Thank you, sir. Chris Erickson?
We have a secret ballot, so it's no one's business who I'm going to vote for. What the problem with our elections is that corporations like Vermont PBS, it's full well known, excluded me from many debates this summer. I was a candidate for governor for the Democratic Party, and I was excluded from many debates. I was a candidate for U.S. Senate also for the Democratic Party, and Senator Leahy refused to debate me, which proves he is un-American, sexist, and undemocratic, because he refused to debate me. Now, furthermore, in 14 years, because I have been on the ballot every 2 years, starting in 2002, for governor, U.S. Senator, and U.S. Congress, Vermont Public Radio has never invited me to even one general election candidate debate. They should lose their federal funding that they receive through NPR. Vermont Public Radio is a fascist, totalitarian, undemocratic, and un-American.
Thank you, Chris. Senator Leahy, you're next.
Well, I've stated publicly I'll vote for Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine for president and vice president.
Simple as that. Mr. Mill.
Well, I just want to clear up a couple things. Senator Leahy did vote against Clarence Thomas. He also voted against Rehnquist as a Supreme Court justice who's got a Vermont home. He also, well, I think you also, you know, along with Senator Kennedy, essentially turned borking into a verb in the 80s. I would argue that was one of the initial steps into the hyper-partisan United States Senate that exists now. Pat Leahy has his fingerprints all over that. In the Bush administration, there were all kinds of federal judges that were being held up. You are claiming one year you're in favor of the Thurman rule, then the next year you don't remember what the Thurman rule is. So that needs to be cleared up. The second thing that I really think needs to be cleared up is this narrative that my opponent has of Milne can't separate a fact from an attack. Well, I think it can be confusing, but there's a big difference. I talk about facts. I sent out a press release today talking about my positive vision for getting the United States Senate back on track. Your campaign and your party sent out two press releases saying negative things about me. So don't say you're not running a negative campaign. You are.
Before we get to Mr. Trudell, we're going to give Senator...
He didn't answer the question.
Exactly. But he did use his time to talk as he wished. If he didn't answer, we'll get to one. Senator Leahy, a rebut on that, and then we're going to get to Mr. Trudell on the question.
Justice Rehnquist was a friend of mine. I voted for him for justice. I voted against him for Chief Justice, and I told him that I would because of some answers he gave regarding a clause, basically an anti-Semitic clause in his deed to his home here in Vermont. I don't believe he was anti-Semitic, but he didn't think it really made that much difference. And so I voted against him for Chief Justice. But I voted for justice, and we remain very close friends right up to the time he died.
Sir, Mr. Trudell, the question is, voting for who are you voting for president?
I don't like either of the major party candidates for many, many reasons. I would vote for someone who isn't running like, let's say, Ralph Nader, who has integrity, vision, and is on the right track. That's a tough question for me because the choices are so slim, and that's partly because we have, or maybe largely because we have, a dysfunctional two-party system in this country, which is, again, my convictions about being an independent candidate. So I can tell you who I don't want to vote for, either the Democrat or the Republican. Maybe I'll vote for Jill Stein. I'm still evaluating, and I'm looking. There's a guy, I'm a Republican out, a Mormon. I might vote for him. You know that guy? He got on the ballot because he didn't like Trump's candidacy. Does that ring a bell?
Mr. Milne, you did not answer the question earlier about who you'd vote for president, which has been characteristic of you for the last half a year. I asked you repeatedly whether you would support your party's presidential nominee, Mr. Trump. For much of that time, he continued to make comments that denigrated women, Muslims, the disabled, Mexican Americans, et cetera, and you still wouldn't answer the question. Only after after the recent comments came out from that Access Hollywood tape did you say you would not vote for Mr. Trump. So can you explain to me what happened there? Why was it that pushed you over the edge?
Sure, great question, Paul. Well, first of all, I answered the question from the day one and said I was not supporting Donald Trump. I would also say, unlike Senator Leahy, I'm not running my campaign by running down his nominee. I haven't said one bad word about Hillary Clinton in this entire campaign. Again, press release from your campaign today comparing me to Donald Trump and saying I'm like Donald Trump and all this stuff. So I'm running my campaign. I've got a positive vision about Vermont. I'm running for the United States Senate. I've announced early on I'm not supporting any candidate. I announced after some of this stuff that just became completely inconsistent that Donald Trump was saying with my belief that as candidates we need to inspire young people. So I announced or responded to your question and said I'm not voting for him, and that was a couple weeks ago. But I've been very consistent.
Given him two chances to answer the same question.
Mr. Leahy, a quick follow-up for you as well. Unlike most Vermont Democrats, you did not support Senator Sanders in the presidential primary. Do you regret that at all at this point?
No, I'm doing exactly what Senator Sanders is now. We're both supporting Hillary Clinton. He is supporting me and the rest of the Democratic ticket. He's a good friend. I think the world of him. Had he been the nominee, I would have campaigned around the country for him. He knows that. But I gave my word early on to support Hillary Clinton long before he said anything about running for president. I think Vermonters know I always keep my word.
And just a quick one to Mr. Diamondstone. You've run against Senator Sanders for years. Used to be good friends and roommates with him, if I recall correctly.
Run. I've been a candidate occasionally, but I've never run. Mm-hmm.
Did you support him when he ran for president?
Did I support Sanders?
That's correct.
In a sense, I did. I mean, I told people not to underestimate him. I told him that I thought he was raising some issues that were fairly important, but they could be found in Bill Myers' platform of 1958 or Teddy Roosevelt's platform of 1904. And so it wasn't a really exciting thing, but it was more exciting than the others, capitalists. But none of them raised the real issues, which how much are we going to confiscate from the owners of the wealth? Are we going to have a single-class society, or are we going to have a multi-class society with a ruling class, a middle class, and a lower class? And them supports three classes. Me supports one class, and it should be done by confiscatory taxation.
Thank you, sir. A topic of national and international concern, climate change. And Olivia Arms from Shelburne, Vermont, wants to combine that with a topic of near dear to Vermont, agriculture. And she says, in anticipation of a changing climate, what kinds of policies can be introduced by you to ensure our local agriculture is sustainable in the face of challenges, flooding, chemical runoff into Lake Champlain, and release of greenhouse gases? We're going to start on this end with Mr. Trudeau.
Yeah. I'm glad you brought that up. What we need to do is to greatly increase our cow power. For those of you who don't know what that means methane digestion. I believe currently in the state we have 17 methane digesters. We need about 117. We need to set up co-ops so that every dairy farmer can recycle and treat, and at the same time power perhaps 50,000 homes in Vermont. This would be one of the biggest steps to controlling runoff and climate change. And why are we not doing it? I think because we don't have the vision and the ambition in this corner. Okay, that's part of the reason. Now, the other answers to climate change, look at my 10-point proposal. We need solar heating and solar hot water for every farm, home, and business in Vermont, and we don't have it. Instead, what do we have? A poor excuse for climate change solutions? Tearing up our ridge lines with industrial-scale wind turbines, which the Vermont Law School just recently said isn't helping one iota. Thank you.
I'm going to mix up the order here. I'm going to start over. Mr. Diamondstone?
Total unilateral disarmament will end the issue of climate change. It takes one tank, 35 gallons, to travel 1 mile. The largest consumer of fossil fuel in the world is the United States military. Let's stop the existence of that military, end war, which will also end those acts of fossil fuel consumption by all the other powers in the world. That's the first place to start, is to end the use of war as a tool of policy.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Milne.
I want to, in the U.S. Senate race in New Hampshire, they're having 15 debates. In the governor's race in Vermont, there's 15 debates and forums. This is the second opportunity we've had to talk to each other in a public forum. So I want to just address a couple things that came up before. On climate change and agriculture, my position is very similar to Senator Leahy's. I'd be glad to talk about that. Senator Leahy says, everybody knows when he gives his word, he keeps his word, and that's why he couldn't support Senator Sanders, because he came out with Clinton early. I will say one of the reasons that I'm into this race is because I don't agree with that. I think Senator Leahy says he's for transparency. He writes press releases about himself, that he's Senator Sunshine, and we need transparency on everything. Yet when I ask him to release his emails about the EB-5 Ponzi scheme in the kingdom and all these things that are going on in Hollywood, he won't respond. He says he wants to get money out of politics. I challenge him to a campaign like George Aiken with a $100 campaign. He doesn't want to do that. I do an Elizabeth Warren template. He won't do that. Furthermore, when he was a United States Senator, he took an oath of office to uphold the Constitution, and he leaked classified documents. So the first two maybe are gray areas. The last one's pretty clearly somebody that doesn't always tell the truth and keep his word.
Thank you, sir. Chris Erickson, I'm going to go to you, and allow me a second to reintroduce this topic, which is agriculture and the future of agriculture in the face of climate change in Vermont.
Okay, on an international level, which is very important, Senator Leahy is obviously against doing anything positive and constructive because he wants to bring the F-35 strike fighter jets to Vermont, which are dual capable of carrying nuclear weapons. And he has advocated selling these worldwide to our allies. Now, what happens when we drop bombs in Syria or we give money or bombs to someone else to drop them in Syria, in Yemen, or Iraq, anywhere else, is when the bombs drop, they emit exothermic decomposition products, which include lead dust and lead fumes. The lead dust goes into the soil and the water and ruins it for the people in that area. The lead fumes go into the air. This affects climate change and it affects agriculture. It destroys agriculture. Everywhere we drop bombs, we're destroying agriculture because of the exothermic decomposition products include lead dust.
Thank you, Chris Erickson. Mr. Leahy.
Well, I'm not one of those people who deny there's climate change and global warming. I'm absolutely convinced there is, as most scientists are. I think that the steps recently taken, when so many nations came together in Paris and signed an agreement to lower one, the use of fossil fuel, but to clean up the air in their own country, was a very positive step. We could spend hours going over the details. But I'd say that Mr. Trudeau has a very good point on the methane digesters. I agree with him on that. The mechanics are such that we're looking at in the Agriculture Committee and others. I think we have to help a lot of Vermonters be able to do it because it can be expensive initially. In the long run, it saves us money. You can make energy and you can keep the water clean. I spent a career trying to keep our streams and Lake Champlain clean.
Thank you, sir. Paul, you have a follow-up?
New question for you all. According to the Government Accountability Office, the federal EB-5 immigrant investor visa program has been plagued with fraud over the years, including allegedly right here in Vermont in the Northeast Kingdom. Do you believe that Congress erred in establishing a program so easy to abuse? And what specific changes would you make to the program?
Let's start with Mr. Milne this time.
Thanks for the question. Senator Leahy is the self-proclaimed godfather of the EB-5 program. And I philosophically, I think we need to do what's practical with government. I appreciate people that philosophically think it's like selling citizenship. I happen to disagree. I think there's a good place for a limited number of visas in an EB-5 kind of program in the United States government. I think the program was poorly designed. I think if you look around the country, you see we've got the $200 million alleged Ponzi scheme in the kingdom. We've got Harry Reid's son who's involved in an EB-5 scandal in Nevada. You've got Hillary Clinton's brother that's involved in an EB-5 scandal. We've got Senator Leahy's daughter who's an EB-5 lobbyist for Hollywood EB-5 interests. I think the United States Senate has turned the EB-5 program into a job creation thing for their family and friends, and most of them are failing at it. Your daughter, I think, is pretty good at it, but everybody else seems to be failing at it. So I think it's a big problem. It needs to be overhauled, but philosophically, I think it's a good program. It's something I'll be better than my opponent based on his track record at getting it fixed and getting it back on track.
Senator Leahy, you're next.
It's interesting because the EB-5, first, let's point out there are some success stories. Sugar Bush. Every morning when I look out the window of my home here in Vermont, I look down the Mad River Valley, I see Sugar Bush ski area. They've followed the rules. They've done everything right. They've created a lot of jobs. Marcel and I coming out of church a couple of Sundays ago were talking to somebody who has a good job there. What happened in the Northeast Kingdom is an outrage. It is wrong. People try to game the system, apparently, from what we've heard. The SEC and others are looking into it. I commend them for doing that. Anybody who broke the law or didn't follow the law should be punished for it. But let's not forget that it was intended to bring good people in the Northeast Kingdom jobs. My wife and my mother were both born in the kingdom. I care very much about that place. And I'm glad to see the receiver says that both Jay Peake and Burke will be open. That's a step. But we've got to dramatically revise the law or get rid of it.
Thank you. Chris Erickson, the EB-5 system.
Okay, the EB-5 program I think is basically good. I did a video on it in 2008, 8 years ago, and I bought the domain eb-5.biz, and I've only had, in 8 years, only a few visitors. In fact, I got so discouraged this summer that I moved the domain forwarding to the United States Marijuana Party, because I'd gone 8 years with only a couple of visitors to my website and I hadn't found any investors. But now I realize that it's probably the man they call the Godfather, the number one criminal in the US Senate, US Senator Patrick Leahy, who's probably done something to stop the search engines from getting to my domain, eb5.biz, eb-5.biz.
Thank you. Peter Diamondstone.
I think it's a lot like the other Ponzi schemes, how the wealthy can keep their money and do things like fund the station or keep their money and control our culture through a station like this, the plays that get produced and so forth. Instead of letting the taxpayers take their money and let the taxpayers decide how that money should be used. The same is true of Harvard's fund that doesn't get taxed. Why isn't it taxed? Why does the working class have to pay for the wealthy to go to school? That money should be taxed just like anything else, but no. It's part of the Ponzi scheme of the wealthy to fund their favorite things at the expense of the working class. We have to talk about people paying loans on their school and so forth at this late date in our lives while the working class supports.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Trudell, Paul's question was about the EB-5 system.
After taking a good look at this because of all the press, and I have to comment that this is the largest scandal in the history of the state of Vermont. It's no wonder it's so shocking. And to me, what's shocking is that there was no oversight, by admission. None. Zippo. They didn't even hire a part-time accountant, which they could have done and which I would have done. Now, let's bounce to the national level. The Real Deal, which is a publication in New York City which covers the real estate industry, referred to EB-5 as the crack cocaine of real estate investing. And they listed all the major firms that are doing what? They're building luxury housing that no one needs. 9 out of 10 New Yorkers can't afford. They're actually making the problem worse. And let's not forget here in Vermont, the Newport crater. I'm proposing that we earmark a certain amount of the funds that are in receivership to go towards an investment fund to do something about this. And I'd like to know what Senator Leahy's suggestion is on this. My closing comment is that it is a crying shame that this is the best that we have to rebuild this country is a scheme. Why don't we have a blueprint? Thank you.
Senator Leahy.
Paul has a follow-up.
You just heard Mr. Trudell say there's no oversight on this program. For a very long time, your office called you the, quote, leading champion of EB-5 in the United States Senate. Do you feel that you bear any responsibility for what's happened in the Northeast Kingdom? I know you've pointed out some of the successes of the program, but of course there have been many other failures throughout the country.
I bear a responsibility to keep pushing to make the changes I've been asking for long before the EB-5 scandal in the Northeast Kingdom, something Senator Grassley, a Republican, and I have worked for. And I will continue to push for that. It's a state-run program, but I want to see these changes, or we shouldn't have it. I think that immigration, of course, is a major issue. We passed an immigration bill through the Senate with 68 votes. The Republican leadership in the House said they couldn't take it up because it would violate the Hastert rule. They had such reverence for former Speaker Hastert, they couldn't bring it up. I wish they had. We would have had some EB-5 improvements in that. We're just going to keep trying. I have Republicans and Democrats who want to. I think this will show what's happened in New York City and what's happened in the Northeast Kingdom shows the need for those changes.
Senator, you mentioned immigration, and that's exactly where we wanted to go next. Much has been mentioned in the national debate this presidential year about immigration, immigration reform, what to do, what not to do. By some accounts, we have 11 million undocumented immigrants in this country. I'm going to start with Mr. Trudell. What is the fix for this obviously broken system?
a prosperous economy for all with an expanding job base, which history teaches does happen and will happen if we have some vision here for a change instead of the same old status quo politics. We need innovation, vision for the 21st century. There will be enough jobs for everyone when we do this, just as there have been in past periods of prosperity. Let's not forget that immigrants built this country.
What are we doing with the 11 million immigrants currently inside the U.S.?
We are going to create employment and prosperity for everyone in this country, not just those 11 million, so that people are not playing the blame game, blaming each other for stealing jobs from each other. That is absolutely ridiculous and absurd. When we've got so much we need to do in this country to build and to rebuild, there's plenty of work for everyone. That's what I believe.
Mr. Milne.
Well, as I said in my opening, our nation and our planet are in perilous times. The old ideas are not working. My opponent wants us to believe that he and his senior career politician friends are going to get together after this election and become nonpartisan and fix this immigration issue. I think what we need is a resurgence of the New England Republican. Hopefully there'll be some Dixie Democrats that show up down the road, get some people in the middle that can actually get things done. As far as philosophy, I mean, I could talk about the 1,000% increase in illegal immigrants that are in the country since my opponent's been in office, which is a fact. Could talk about a lot of things like that. The reality is we need to get a pathway to citizenship for the 11 million people that are here, most of them except for some that should be deported. We need to get a e-verification process in place. So I think Senator Leahy and I agree on what needs to happen. I just would argue I'm going to be a much better person to get it done. I'll be a centrist. He's a partisan.
Senator, you're next.
Well, I've demonstrated I can do it. In the Senate, we put together a group of Republicans and Democrats. They met almost weekly, sometimes daily, in my office because they knew I was an honest broker. We brought the immigration bill before the Senate Judiciary Committee. They filed hundreds and hundreds of amendments. I said, we'll hear each one of them. We have a Republican amendment and then a Democratic amendment. And we went back and forth, day after day, sometimes to midnight, until we passed a bill. Both the Republican and Democratic leadership in the Senate said this was a good move. It was done in the way we used to do things, where Republicans and Democrats worked together. I don't talk about it, I do it. And we got 68 votes for it in the United States Senate, one of the highest number of votes on any complicated issue that we've seen in years.
Chris Erickson, immigration reform?
In insurance law, there's a legal theory called attractive nuisance. So if you build a swimming pool, but you fail to put a fence around it, and the neighborhood children get into it, and one of them drowns, you're liable because you built an attractive nuisance and forgot to put a fence around it, or just didn't. The United States of America is the same thing. We brag about being the greatest country in the world. So because we're bragging about being the greatest country in the world, we have created an attractive nuisance. And 11 million illegal aliens have barged their way in. So we're going to have to accept them under some program, create a program to accept them. But then we have got to control our borders. We have to vote for federal funding to have real control of our borders.
Thank you. Peter Diamondstone.
Ultimately, I think we need to do away with the borders so that somebody from South America or from South Africa can come here freely without any challenge. We have some problems about safety issues now because we've armed the world and we've made everybody into a dangerous person. So we do have to take some precautions until we stop arming the world. And so it begins with an embargo on the exportation of all armaments and ammunition from the United States. Not one penny's worth can be shipped out of the United States. That's the beginning. And the second, ultimately, we need to go to a situation where we encourage everybody to go to any part of the planet. We're all citizens of the planet. And that's where we begin. We're all citizens of this planet.
Mr. Milne, you were mentioned earlier. You want to
Well, I hope folks at home will pay attention. It's a legitimate argument. Do you want experience or do you want new ideas? I've got a background in the private sector where getting things done means getting things done. We just heard experience say, I don't just talk about things, I get things done, because you got 68 votes on a bill in the Senate that went nowhere to fix an immigration problem that's been getting worse over the last 42 years. Those are old ideas. That's somebody that doesn't really get what really happens on main streets. Those folks that are struggling to figure out how to pay people are struggling to figure out how to pay your bills. Old ideas like I got 68 votes in a bill that went nowhere, like he's some sort of savant of the US Senate, is what's wrong with Washington. We need people that are common people. Our country was designed for people like me to step forward and serve. Our US Senate is designed for people like this. Justin Morrill, one of the great senators in American history, had no experience at all in government, stepped forward from Stratford, Vermont, Orange County, county I'm gonna win 13 days, 12 days from today. I'm looking forward to it.
Quick rebut, sir.
You know, Mr. Milne has run a campaign based solely on attacking me. The fact is Republicans and Democrats agree that what I did with the immigration bill should have been followed up in the House of Representatives, where his party blocked it. Now they want to have more members of his party to block more things. I would hope not. I actually do get things done. So Justin Morrill is the greatest senator this country ever had. He made it before he got in there, and he made it with his relationships with both Republicans and Democrats and the President of the United States to get things done.
If you are just joining us at the bottom of the hour now, this is the United States Senate debate here on Vermont PBS. I'm Joe Merone. Paul Heintz from 7 Days is joining me in questioning these five candidates on the ballot this election day. We were talking about the immigration system being broken and in need of a fix. Here's something else that may possibly be in the same category, Social Security. Vermont is the second oldest state in the United States, and Social Security is probably on the minds of more than most. But it's the young who may worry about its future solvency. What is the fix, if there is one, for Social Security? Chris Erickson, we'll begin with you.
I have a two-attack plan to start with, and that's just to start with. Number one, I'm going to get a ton of money by, let me explain how. The taxpayers are paying our taxes to the Treasury. The US Congress, the House and Senate vote to give them to the National Institute of Health, the NIH. The NIH decides to give your money to pharmaceutical companies who invent prescription drugs, and then they make all the profit. But because the taxpayers paid for the inventions of these prescription drugs and medical devices, the taxpayers should own 50% of the profit. So that money, that 50%, will go back into Social Security. The same with the Pentagon. The taxpayers' money is being voted on by the US Congress, House, and Senate. It goes to the Pentagon. The Pentagon gives millions and millions and millions, trillions, to defense corporations. The defense corporations make F-35 jets and sell them to foreign countries. Where's the taxpayers' 50%? The taxpayers paid for the research, design, and development. They should own 50% of the profits. Put that back into Social Security.
Thank you, Chris Erickson. Mr. Leahy, Social Security's future.
Now, I think you raise a very good question on Social Security. It is a social contract also that we have in this country. I've been paying into Social Security since I think I was 11 years old. As I worked my way through college and the jobs I held after college and after law school. Now, the next generation is doing the same. There has to be guarantees to be there. A Republican candidate for president has proposed a tax plan that would give enormous cuts to the wealthiest. It would take billions of dollars out of the budget, and it'd make it impossible to keep Social Security where it is. That's the wrong way to go. I think just as Senator Bob Dole and Senator Pat Moynihan, two very experienced men of different parties, came together to save Social Security before it's going to be done again.
Thank you. Mr. Milne.
Well, I just want to go back to Senator Leahy's last question where I pointed out that he's claiming a victory lap for getting 68 votes on a bill that went nowhere. And he calls that an attack. That's a fact. You go play tape back. He just declared victory for getting 68 votes on a bill that went nowhere. That's not attack. That's a fact. I think things can be confusing, but we need to have leaders that can tell the difference between an attack and a fact, particularly somebody that might be third in line for having his finger on the nuclear code. There's a big difference between an attack and a fact. And if you, when you get to the United States Senate, especially after you've been there 42 years, you should know that. What I hear is your side attacking my presidential, my party's presidential nominee all the time, like I'm Donald Trump. People that know me realize I'm the furthest thing from Donald Trump. What we need to do to fix Social Security is exit folks like Patrick Leahy, who are career politicians that are more worried about getting reelected. They've run up a $20 trillion debt on the books. If you count promises that folks like him have made so they don't have to make tough decisions to get reelected election after election after election, we've got a $160 trillion deficit. Career politicians out of the way will fix a lot of problems. That's what my campaign is about.
Thank you. Mr. Trudell, your plan for Social Security.
Well, first of all, I think Social Security is one of the greatest institutions that this country has ever created. It's extremely important. What would all those senior citizens do who are on those fixed incomes if they didn't have those fixed incomes? So I support fixing when necessary, by any means necessary. Not skimping, not wasting money on pork barrel projects that we don't need, that don't do a darn thing, but supporting Social Security completely for now and posterity.
No specifics.
Whatever it takes. By any means necessary.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Diamondstone, future of Social Security.
Even within the capitalist structure, it's not a difficult problem to solve. I mean, when I talk about getting rid of the military budget, that could be a beginning. But without getting to those extremes, how about starting to tax those sources of income which are not taxed for Social Security? For example, capital gains. You don't pay Social Security tax on capital gains. Why not? Why don't you pay capital gains on rents? Why don't you pay, tax on Social Security tax on rent? The capitalists have given us such a free ride that it now turns up that Trump doesn't pay any taxes at all. So it's a very easy solution, but the capitalists won't solve it. It's going to take socialists to do it. And that will begin with no more money for war. And that will give us the money to provide Social Security, increase Social Security, and put everybody on Medicare from birth to death.
Quick follow-up to you, Mr. Milne. You said that you were the furthest thing from Donald Trump, but 2 years ago when you ran against Governor Shumlin and lost the popular vote to him, you refused to concede and contested it in front of the legislature. Right now, Donald Trump is threatening not to concede if he does not win the popular vote or the Electoral College vote. How are you different from Mr. Trump in that regard?
Great question, Paul. Thanks for asking that. 2 years ago, as you know, closest gubernatorial election in Vermont history. I was outspent about 5-1, 6-1 maybe. I think as I let absorb what happened on election day, I realized that we have a constitution that's built for times like that. I used what the constitution enabled me to do, which was to press it to the legislature for a vote. I believe if three leading Democrats in the legislature would have agreed, and all I did to the legislators was pointed out what the constitution required, in my opinion. Vote for who you think is going to be the best governor. They did that, I lost. So I followed the Constitution. That's much different than Hillary Clinton getting 400 electoral votes and deciding somehow the election was rigged. It's apples and oranges.
Quick response, Ms. Erickson.
Yes, there was something wrong with the election 2 years ago. First, there was the unofficial vote count that came in, and then the next several days later, they had the official vote count. So the official vote count didn't come for several days, and from the unofficial to the official vote count, my votes were mysteriously cut in half.
So were mine.
So were Jerry Trudell's and one other candidate for U.S. Congress. So there's definitely something rotten to the core in Montpelier.
Thank you. And
I wasn't on the ballot, so I don't have it.
You're
I
the only one, Senator.
Any problem.
We're going to move on now quickly to the next
question. Great similarity between their capitalist counting methods and Joseph Stalin, who said, It's not how the people vote, it's who counts the votes that matters.
All right, well, we're going to move on now to the next question, which is about campaign finance. Senator Leahy, you've accepted almost $1.5 million worth of donations from special interest political action committees this election cycle. And you, Mr. Milne, have loaned your campaign, or you loaned your 2014 campaign $80,000. So the question to all of you is, what can we do, if anything, to ensure that not just the wealthy and their friends can win public office in the United States? And should we start with?
We'll go left to right, Mr. Madison.
I thought I'd run off a whole rack of them. Like, first is confiscatory taxation so that the people own the major means of production and distribution. And so nobody will have that excess wealth that they contribute to elections. The second, of course, is to say, no, this is a job application. It's not a gladiatorial event. And when you apply for a job, we don't allow you to spend any money to do that, to get our votes. You can make a presentation. You can do what we do here. We can do what they do on radio. And it should evenly be allocated to all the candidates so that everybody has an equal opportunity to present their views. That's the way to make the change. Just get money out of politics, period.
Campaign finance reform, Chris Erickson.
Yes, to stop only wealthy people from being elected, I would pass a federal law that says Vermont PBS can't have one penny of federal funding unless you include all candidates in all debates. And you know at Vermont PBS that I have been excluded from many debates. The same for Vermont Public Radio. I'll pass a federal law. Vermont Public Radio can't get one penny of federal funding, even if they're getting it through NPR or other ways. They're getting it, not one penny for them, so long as they exclude any candidates from any debates, such as their upcoming debate with Scott Milne and Senator Leahy, who are the rich guys here, and they're going to make themselves, one of them is going to become even wealthier and become, you know, well, maybe not.
Thank you, Chris Erickson. Pat Leahy.
Rarely ever been called a rich guy, but I'll accept that.
Don't lie.
Let's understand what's happened. One of the worst things in this country was first the Citizens United decision, which gutted the McCain-Feingold bill. And then when the attempt was made by the Congress to restore much of McCain-Feingold, it came within one vote of passing, but John McCain voted against restoring it. As a result, there is so much dark money. Look what's happened in New Hampshire. Before Maggie Hassan announced, and she's a well-qualified person, $10 million of dark money was spent to defeat her. Now there's been 40 or 50 million. That has to change.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Milne, campaign finance reform.
Well, it's a big problem, and it doesn't specifically answer your question, Paul, about rich people and things like that. But we put out some specific proposals on reforming the federal election and campaign finance system. Welcome people to go to scottmilne.org, check that out, or shoot us an email. We'll have one of my volunteers get in touch with you. I think it's a big issue. This deadly concoction of career politicians being propped up election after election by either rich people or special interests is a big problem. I'm offering Vermonters that agree that it's a big problem, myself as your messenger. I'm running a campaign where I haven't sent one mail piece, one email, one direct mail piece to ask anybody for money. My opponent has spent more money on professional fundraising consultants in the last 18 months than I spent on a governor's campaign and a US Senate campaign to date combined. That speaks volumes to what's wrong.
Mr. Trudell?
Compared to me, you're a big spender. I'm running a no budget campaign. What I'm saying is that we need to create a level playing field. It isn't just about campaign finance. It's about people like you, Paul Heintz, completely ignoring people who are on the ballot. When they do leave messages, they do send press releases, and they do have substantial ideas here. Okay? So yes, I'll support more than campaign finance reform. I'll support a level playing field in which all candidates who are on the ballot have a chance to debate. How can you possibly vote for someone if you don't know about them? So that's what I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Trudell. Well, it has been a spirited and fast-moving 90 minutes. I want to thank you all for being here. We picked order of closing statements earlier, and Chris Erickson, you're number one.
Alrighty, I hope you vote for me for United States Senator. I will go down there to Washington, D.C. and sponsor a bill to make marijuana legal. I will do everything I can to stop the F-35 strike fighter jets from being based in Burlington, Vermont, because they are dual capable to carry nuclear bombs and they do not belong adjacent to the Burlington International Airport. I will do everything I can to get federal funding to reroute treated sewage away from Lake Champlain. It is disgusting that dozens of sewage treatment plants are dumping treated sewage into Lake Champlain, from which one-third of Vermonters are drawing their drinking water. I will do everything I can to get more federal funding for senior citizen disabled housing here in Vermont. I will do everything I can to make a program for veterans, for housing designed by veterans that they would feel comfortable in, because so many of them have post-traumatic stress disorder. They need to design their own housing. We need federal funding for it and for dental for veterans.
Thank you, Chris Erickson. Next order of close, Mr. Jerry Trudell, Independent.
First of all, I'd like to say what I said in the opening, that the number one problem is we have a permanent recession economy. We're the poorest rich country in the world, and there is no excuse for that when we have the skills, the tools, and the dreams to build a better world. What I'm proposing is a specific set of solutions called a blueprint for prosperity, my 10-point plan. I'm urging all of you to read that, and if you like it, I'm urging you to tell your friends, because word of mouth is still the most powerful advertisement. In closing, what I'd like to do is I'd like to quote Senator Leahy 42 years ago. Once again, he said, "It's time to bring a fresh approach and leadership to government." So what I say is, yes, it's time to do that again. Let's recycle that. We need more than experience. We need the vision to go with it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Trudell. Next order of closing statement is Patrick Leahy.
Well, I'm running for re-election because I want to continue delivering for Vermont. I've gone all over the state. One of the things that has given me some hope, person after person has told me they appreciate the fact that I'm not running a negative campaign, I'm running a positive campaign. I think the polls show what has happened. Negative campaign has been run against me. I don't stoop to that. I keep the positive. They know, as I did with Tropical Storm Irene, I worked together with our delegation, the governor. We brought hundreds of millions of dollars to Vermont to bring us out of that situation. But it's not just bringing money to the state. I believe firmly that the Senate can be and should be the conscience of the nation. We have seen some of the most negative campaigns, the presidential level and across the country, we've ever seen. People are discouraged by it. I think I can demonstrate I don't run negative campaigns, and I can use that to help bring us back together.
Thank you, sir. Closing statement next is Mr. Diamondstone.
Socialist Party. Liberty Union is the socialist party for the state of Vermont. And when I say socialism, I'm not talking about social democrats and making modest changes to the capitalist system. I'm talking about getting rid of the capitalist system altogether, getting rid of private ownership of the major means of production and distribution. Those things should belong to the people, not to private individuals. We need, and that's the beginning of stopping war. Without that, we can't stop war. As long as there is capitalism, there'll be war. And that's the source of the evil in this society, is the use of capital to bring down socialist governments, like the guy in Haiti that we kidnapped twice. Go back to Mossadegh in 53. See, and it's every president. Usually we can start in 53 and go right on.
Thank you, Mr. Diamondstone. Our last closing statement, Mr. Milne.
Thank you, Senator Leahy, everybody. Peter Diamondstone, great to be with you again this year. As I said, our nation and our planet are in perilous times. The old ideas are not working. We need to change what's happened in the United States Senate. I have a positive vision. I'm running a positive campaign about reforming government. I built a small business. I've got about 100 people that depend on my business for payroll. I built that business with an inverted triangle. I'm down here, everybody's up here, customers are up here. That's the model I'll use as your servant, as your United States Senator, should I be blessed with a victory on November 8th. Looking forward to getting to work. We'll go back and remind you, I believe the message that will be sent with a Scott Milne election against a guy with $6 million with almost no money is going to accomplish more to make America a better place 20 years from now than my opponent, even with a really good 6 years ahead of him, is going to accomplish in the whole term. Everything I do beyond that, I'll work really hard. It'll be a bonus. I'm looking forward to it. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Milne. And thank you to all the candidates for your time today. And thank you, Paul, for joining us, and Laura, for keeping time. And thank you for all viewers for watching us. And remind you that Election Day is Tuesday, November 8th, less than 2 weeks from today. November 8th. We hope that through these debates, we've helped you make an informed decision, and we encourage you to exercise your rights and get out and vote on that day. And to tune into Vermont PBS that night for complete PBS NewsHour coverage of the unfolding events. For everyone here at Vermont PBS, I'm Joe Merone. Good evening, everyone.